Hey, Jody here. Let's do it.
In a previous video, I showed the root pass technique where I go forward and back using the lay wire technique. And so I don't walk the cup. I just freehand with a TIG finger, straight forward, straight back. And then also did a fill pass and a cover pass freehanding with a TIG finger. And I'll link those up right here. But they look something like this. It's a good technique. Walking the cup is a good technique also. You can't always walk the cup because sometimes there are things in the way. Both of them have their pros and cons. So for this video, we're going to really tackle walking the cup. And it really helps to have different cup sizes when you're walking the cup because you've got all kinds of situations where you got different wall thicknesses, different bevel angles and whatnot. I like to use these big, large diameter gas lenses. And I'm going to start off with a number 6 cup. Cups are marked in increments of 16ths, so a 6 cup is 6/16ths or 3/8ths on the inside diameter. I like to grip it different ways depending on the situation, but you want to select a cup size that will wiggle on the hot pass just about like this. Now sometimes you just don't have a choice. You're stuck with a cup size. It's not ideal. Here's a large one, a number 10, in which case you can rock it. Listen to this. That works pretty good too, just whatever it takes. But it really does help to have a selection of cup sizes. I'm gonna be using a 6 here for the hot pass because it seems to wiggle in there quite nicely. When you're in the groove like this, the cup just wiggles. But when you're out on a cover pass, it's more like a figure eight, like walking a 55-gallon drum across a shop floor. So let's do the hot pass. 105 amps, 1/8 inch, ER309L filler rod because I'm welding carbon steel pipe to a stainless steel flange. Not for any real reason. I just happened to get some flanges without having to actually buy them. So I'm going to wind up making a stand out of this thing for either a vise or to hold test pieces while I weld on them and shoot video. Your main goal on the hot pass is to not screw up the root pass. Since I'm using stainless here, normally I would keep the purge going for the hot pass, maybe even the pass after that, but for the sake of this thing, since I've done several practice runs to get this video done, to get enough arc shots and whatnot, I pulled the purge hose out, but it's best practice to leave the purge on. You never know if you might accidentally get hung up, get going too slow, and melt through, and then you'll sugar on the inside. So you don't want to spend a whole lot of time across the middle. Just kind of go at a fairly good clip from side to side. And of course, that comes with a little practice. When you're first learning, you want to get the technique down first and then your speed will come later. I'm going a little bit slower than probably I should here because I'm a little bit out of practice. One thing I can see though is this hot pass is not filling it up quite as much as it did in a previous video where I freehanded the hot pass. So I'm going to need another fill pass on there before I'm ready for a cover pass. And so I'm going to jump up to another size larger cup. I'm going to go from a 6 up to a number 8 here for the fill pass. Now this pass, I'm not riding on a groove or anything. So I am doing like a figure 8, kind of like rolling a 55-gallon drum across a shop floor. And the ripples in the weave and the speed of progression are kind of controlled by your wrist and how big of steps you take each time you come across. A lot of that is a matter of preference, but some of it's not. Sometimes you really want to get finished with if you're in a pipe shop, they don't care how narrow the ripples are maybe. They want that thing done. Maybe you figure out a technique where you increase your travel speed and your ripples are spaced a little farther apart and you get finished quicker. Other than that, a lot of it is preference. Sometimes it's heat input though. Now you see me, I've got this torch kind of held up tight toward the cup, kind of choked up on it. I don't always do that, but this is only 3-inch pipe, schedule 40, 105 amps, so the torch is not getting hot. It gives me a little bit more control. And like I said, I'm a little bit out of practice here. So once I got more comfortable with it, I might grip it further back on the neck. It all depends. If this was a 36-inch heavy wall joint with 2-inch wall thickness, I'd be gripping that thing way down by the handle to get my hand away from the heat. So different techniques for different situations. Well, this fill pass is getting close to being done, and then we'll be ready for the cover pass. I like to let things cool off for a little bit before I just come back on with the cap pass. This has got a heavy flange here, so it's quite a heat sink, so it's going to cool off fairly quickly. But after it cools just a little bit, I'll give it a wire brushing like that. And then while it's still good and warm to the touch, I didn't change my amperage or anything. I'm just going back on it. And I'm going to put a cover pass on there just about like this. This is one of those situations where I kind of wish I had a 5/32 filler wire. I'm using a 1/8 here. A 5/32 would probably let me fill it a little bit easier without having to watch those toes so closely, because I don't want to leave any underfill or any undercut on those toes. You can see a few little areas that just wish there was just a little bit more fill there, so I wouldn't have to watch them to make sure there weren't any scalloped areas that looked a little low. Again, it's like walking a 55-gallon drum across the shop floor. I'm using a foot pedal here today for this joint, so I just kind of trailed out, got more and more narrow as I tapered off amperage, kind of comet trail it out. All right, let's wire brush that off really quickly and then talk about some more tips for walking the cup. A little recap, if you will. You can kind of get the motor skills built by just doing a T-joint fillet weld. This is the same motion I might use on a root pass, on a rollout joint. And then once you've got that root pass in there, and you can either dip or do lay wire, it doesn't really matter. It's good practice doing either one. But once you get a root pass in there like that, you can also use the metal up more by doing a second pass on it. This is very much like a hot pass over top of a root. And you could put this T-joint vertical or overhead or however you wanted to get the practice. Again, cup size is important. Also, electrode extension is important. General rule of thumb is start off with your electrode extended just about what the cup size is. So a number 6 cup, you'd extend the electrode 6/16. I did this video a while back just putting a big chunk of stainless on a turntable just to get some arc shots and show how that works. You can't always walk the cup for every situation. If this was a machine shop job, they might not want these scratches that walking the cup puts on that nice surface of stainless steel. But for pipe, when you're inside a bevel, doesn't matter. Good practice anyway. I know I use that 55-gallon drum analogy a lot, but here's another analogy. Sticking a pen inside a Taco Bell cup, this is what walking the cup looks like, except you're holding on to a torch handle usually. And cup size really matters depending on the scenario, whether you're inside the bevel or out on the surface. You can get some practice on out on the surface like you would on a cover pass. Just get a smooth piece of pipe, round stock, tubing, whatever, scribe some lines or grind some lines and just practice lightly holding the torch. Don't grip it like a gorilla. That's a big mistake. But lightly hold the torch just so you can tell that you're putting light pressure on that surface. And in something smooth like this, if you put too much pressure on it, you'll scoot off of it or slide off of it. So it's good just to get the feel without an arc, without a puddle. Just practice this. Practice holding the torch upside down like this, because you will have to do it. If you're on a shipyard or in a power plant or something, you're going to get in all kind of weird positions. So practice holding it sideways, upside down, and walking it any which way. It's good to build those motor skills before you start welding, before the hood drops. There is a time in which you just have to weld and then it's all different. When you flip the hood down, everything changes. But if you've built those motor skills, it'll help. And like I said before earlier, don't worry about the speed to begin with. The speed will come later. Just get the motion down, watch the puddle, watch the puddle, watch the toes of the weld, make sure they're filling in, not leaving any undercut. Okay, the rest of this video shows a cup kit that I added to my store. Yes, it's a commercial, but I hope you'll stick around. But there will be lots of good arc shots and instructional stuff. I'd like to take a minute now and tell you about these two kits. There's a kit for 9 and 20 style torches and also a kit for 17, 18, 26 style torches. This kit has a cup for practically every situation you would encounter. And I've used every single one of these cups that's in this kit and recommend every single one of them. It is basically all of the kits that I currently sell packed into one big kit and then some. Let's talk about why you would want to use a gas lens to start with. This is a collet body for 17 and 26 style torches. First off, first upgrade I would recommend is a Stubby Gas Lens Kit with that, because not only does it shrink the overall size, it just provides better gas coverage and gives you a longer stick out. This is a number 8 collet body here with a half inch stick out. Didn't do so well. Same stick out with the number 8 gas lens, Stubby Gas Lens, did a lot better. And then you can see when I added the Jazzy Tint to it, it did even better. I really like using a number 6 Stubby Gas Lens for general aluminum welding. It lets me use a long stick out when I need to, but also doesn't give me too much gas coverage. Kind of limits that etching zone around the weld, because where you don't have gas, you won't get that etching zone. The number 8 Clear Pro that you saw me use earlier in this video is a great all-around cup for steel, stainless steel, and aluminum. Lets you use a long stick out, but the main benefit that I have found is just great shielding and lets me see where I'm going. You can see me looking through the cup here on this aluminum puddle. That's very helpful sometimes when you get down in a corner. It just lights the way for me and helps me see the seam, the crack, the joint, whatever. Here you see this is me at working with Mike Zancanato on a bike frame, looking through that number 8 clear cup. That's very helpful sometimes to be able to do that. It's not always needed to be able to see through the cup, but man, when you need it, you need it. This kit also comes with large diameter gas lens collet bodies and wedge collets. Wedge collets don't have a split in them, they just have a wedge. They work great and they last a lot longer than the split version. It comes with a 6, 8, 10, and 12 cup, which are great for walking the cup. They have lots of other uses. They can be used on steel as well as aluminum, but they're really good for walking the cup. And if that's something that you want to learn how to do, or if you're struggling with it, I've got 2 or 3 videos out there. Just search my channel for Walking the Cup TIG Welding. You'll find them. But whether you're walking the cup or not, these cups provide really good gas shielding. And if you're using an air-cooled torch, they add a little bit of extra heat sink to the torch just to keep it from getting so hot. Another cup kit that's added in here is the number 5 cup for aluminum. It's a standard collet body with no gas lens. A lot of people prefer this setup strictly for aluminum. I like to taper my electrode a little bit and then ball it a little bit for a whole lot of aluminum work that I do. It seems to get good arc starts, has a stable arc, but also that number 5 cup limits the amount of cleaning action outside the puddle, and it seems to really focus that energy to the puddle and makes it penetrate a little bit better. This is straight argon here, but man, if you add just a little bit of helium to that, it really makes a difference. Another cup that I really have come to like is the Jazzy 10. It's a number 10 cup, so it only requires about 22 CFH. Here you see it doing a titanium test plate. Even though it's only a number 10 cup, I've got some chill factor going on there with that A-bomb fixture and pretty much made a silver weld with that number 10. This is cold rolled steel, but I'm using Hastelloy C filler metal, and look at that big argon shielded area. It's just about a perfect size cup for TIG brazing with silicon bronze or aluminum bronze. I like to use 2 pulses a second, actually 1.5 to 2 pulses a second, I've found works great. You need your metal clean, and you also need a really good argon shield, and you'll get it with the Jazzy 10. You can extend your electrode out really far with the Jazzy 10, or even farther with the ceramic 12 cup. Using 3/4 of an inch electrode extension is really nothing for this cup. You can go way over an inch with no trouble for those times when you need to. And you don't always need to, but you do sometimes for getting down inside a hole or something like that. Tight cluster joints, just areas where you need a long stick out and you need really good shielding, like on this stainless cope tube joint right here. The clear version of this number 12 cup is also included with a titanium shield on it. You can use it with or without the titanium shield. It's great for your average everyday fillet welds with a long stick out where you can see everything that's going on. You can see that whole big argon shielded area all around the weld there. A fillet weld like this will help trap argon, so it's not that difficult to get good shielding. But on an edge weld like this, the edge wants to split the argon shield, and so having a big blanket of argon gas really helps. On edge welds like this, I find it really helps to use pulse. Here I'm using 50 pulses a second, 33% background, 33% on time. Works great, 25 CFH. For certain alloys, mainly titanium, you need an even larger shield of gas than any of these other cups. This is a BBW, the new design, And Michael Furyk is always improving on his products, but this one works great for titanium. This is a titanium test joint, just like you would take for an aerospace job in a fixture with backup gas on the backside. No discoloration at all, and that's what you're after with titanium. This kit also comes with an assortment of back caps, the long one, the short button, and the intermediate one, along with a 1/16, 3/32, and 1/8, 2% lanthanated electrode for you to try out. This 9 and 20 style kit just uses the smaller hardware, but pretty much uses all the same cups with the same capabilities as the one for 17, 18, 26. This large gas lens here just requires a different heat shield, so you can turn your 920 style torch into something you might want to walk the cup with. If you're in a fab shop and you have a 20 style water cooled torch and you want to use a large gas lens like this, now you got it. So these are basically all the cups you've seen me use in my videos over the past few years, all in one kit for almost every situation. Learn more about the TIG Pro Kit at weldmonger.com. Thank you so much for watching.